evening, everybody, and a very warm welcome on this cold and wintry night to this, the fourth in our series of Jewish Literary Festival at Home conversations. And this series of conversations features authors whom you would have enjoyed at the physical JLF 2020, most of whom are overseas authors who may not be able to join us when we're finally able to stage the event. These sessions, as you probably know, are exclusive for our ticket holders as a token of gratitude for booking. And a recording of each of these sessions will be posted for the wider audience, and we will be advising you of when these are up. If you have any questions for the panelists this evening, please use the Zoom Q&A button, which is at the bottom of your screen. You will be able to type in your question. It will be available throughout the session, but the interviewer will only pick them up in the last 10 to 15 minutes, at which stage he will pose those questions to the guest author. Finally, please watch your inbox for further information on any new webinars that we may be hosting. This evening, we have two acclaimed authors in conversation. The focus is on Jonny Steinberg's new book, One Day in Bethlehem, and Jonathan Ancer is posing the questions. Jonathan Ancer is a journalist who's worked as a reporter at The Star, the editor of Grocott's Mail, and a crossword columnist for the Cape Times. He's won awards for breaking news, feature writing, and creative writing. And he produces the author podcast, I'm a Booker, Booker. He is the author of Spy, Uncovering Craig Williamson, which was chosen by the Sunday Times as one of the top 10 books of 2017. And his latest book, Betrayal, The Secret Lives of Apartheid Spies, was published in 2018. A very warm welcome to Jonathan Ancer and to Jonny Steinberg, and enjoy the evening.
Thank you very much, Beryl. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Jonny. Jonny is a former Rhodes Scholar who has a doctorate in political theory from Oxford University, where he's a professor of African studies. He is the country's leading literary narrative nonfiction author. Jonny writes with elegance and clarity to produce forceful and meticulously researched books. The subjects he tackles are complex and nuanced. When he writes about someone, he takes us on a journey into that person's psyche and allows us to imagine what it means to be that person and spend a few moments in their skin. He doesn't tell us a story, he takes us with him on his own journey of discovery. Jonny wrestles with dark and difficult subjects. His books have won top literary awards and have helped us get to grips with some of the fundamental issues and questions facing South Africa. He opens our eyes to worlds and lives we know very little about, even though we live next door to each other. Jonny has the ability to take a small issue, put it under a magnifying glass, and turn it into a much larger one, from farm murders, to patrolling cops, to prison gangs, to rural Transkei, to New York's Little Liberia, to the life of a Somalian immigrant in xenophobic South Africa. He makes invisible people visible. The book that announced Jonny as a literary powerhouse was his 2002 Tour de Force Midlands, A Very South African Murder. The Number was published 3 years later, then came The Three-Letter Plague, then Little Liberia, and then A Man of Good Hope in 2015. Jonny's latest book, One Day in Bethlehem, was published in September, which wasn't such a long time ago, but it now seems like a lifetime ago. I was blown away by his previous books, but I think One Day in Bethlehem is his best one yet. One Day in Bethlehem keeps on returning to this question: what happened on the 2nd of April, 1992? Jonny, welcome. For the benefit of the people who haven't read the book yet, can you give us a very brief overview of One Day in Bethlehem?
Thanks, Jonathan. Hello, everybody. I'm very sorry that I can't see you. Thanks for the really kind and generous introduction. So let me tell you how I started the book. I was reading the Sunday Times at the end of 2011, and I read about two men who just walked out of prison. They'd been in jail for 19 years for a crime which, by the time they were released, everybody agreed they had not committed. Very, very strangely, they had been to the Truth Commission, along with the people who had committed the crime. Those who committed the crime said, these two guys are innocent. They had nothing to do with it. Their story is correct. And the Truth Commission said to them, we accept your story. You did nothing wrong. And so they gave amnesty to the people who'd committed the crime and said to these two, Fusi Mofokeng and Tsakola Mokoena, because you were innocent, we can't free you. We give amnesty to people who have committed crimes and you have committed none. And they stayed in prison another 12 years. So I read the story in the newspaper in the Sunday Times, and I thought so many things, but one was, what does the world look like to them now? What does post-apartheid South Africa look like all these years late? They're seeing it for the first time. And I immediately wrote to one of them, Fusi Mofokeng. We met a few months later, and what came out was this book. We spent 3-4 years together, many, many hours of time. The book went places I wouldn't have dreamt of when I started it. Many strange twists and turns, some of them quite uncomfortable, a lot to do with memory and what really happened and what didn't happen. That's the gist of it.
So although the book is about Fusi and Tsakola, Fusi is the central focus. Can you tell us about that first meeting that you had with him and how your relationship with him developed over the years that you worked together on the book?
So, you know, generally, if you're going to write intimately about somebody, it helps if they talk a lot. It helps if they reflect on the world around them, if they're philosophical, if they're opinionated. The silent person is incredibly hard to write about. Fusi is a very, very silent, reticent person. you know, he was gentlemanly and polite and quite concealed, quite opaque the first time I met him. And he stayed that way throughout our association. And there were times when I was pulling what's left of my hair out and thought, why did I choose this man? He's not right for this. And in the end, had to look really hard. And in the end, it was really staring me in the face. What I had to work with was precisely his silences and what they meant. And ended up taking him through the landscapes of his childhood, seeing his responses, listening to the quiet of his responses. And that's really where the depths of him came out.
One of the things that impresses me so much about your writing is that you're part of the story, but you never become the story. You insert yourself as a character who is figuring things out. Sometimes you let us into your private thoughts and what's going on. But how do you maintain that balance?
Well, it's a hard one because on the one hand, I don't want to be the story. The story is always about people quite unlike me. But then I also need authenticity and authority. I need the reader to know why I know what I know, especially when I'm walking through a world that's quite foreign to me. And that requires putting myself in the story and saying why I know what I know, showing the reader quite transparently what I'm seeing and why I'm interpreting that way. You know, another reason is that in the last few books, I've largely written about Black South Africans. I'm a white South African. The way somebody relates to me says a huge amount about this country. And so there's something interesting in the relationship between me and the people I write about, something much broader and generative.
I mean, that is something else I wanted to talk to you about, is that you have this amazing ability to get people to open up to you, to get them to collaborate with you, and to trust and to get them to trust you with their stories and their memories. How do you, you know, get them to do that? That is an incredible gift.
I don't think so, actually. I don't think there are any secrets there, and I don't think it's about me. I think it's about them. You know, I think that the people who want to talk, talk, and people who don't want to talk, don't. And in that sense, the subject of the book chooses him or herself. You know, it's quite a thing when you've lived, you know, half of an adult life, and suddenly somebody comes along, and they're more interested in you than anybody else you've ever known. They want to spend hour after hour after hour with you. They write down everything you say. They listen as hard as they possibly can to everything you say. They want to scratch up everything that's ever been known about you. They want to meet everybody from your childhood. It's quite a weird experience. Some people run for the hills and think this is really weird. I just don't want any part of this. I don't want to go through this. Other people are quite seduced by the attention. It's a very unusual form of attention. And in a way that can pose an ethical problem for me. Am I seducing people by what I do? What is my responsibility to them? What do I write down? What is private? What do I leave out? It's not an easy one, especially since to write a readable book, you need to go into the private, you need intimacy. That's what readers want. And so there's a bit of a tension there between the reader and the subject of the book and then whose interests I'm going to serve.
Yes, and how do you find that balance? What is your responsibility to your subject, the person you're writing about, versus the responsibility to the reader? How do you decide?
So I think one thing that's really necessary is that if you are writing about somebody who is not from a literate culture, who's not from a world in which books are read just every day, it's very important to me to give them a draft of that book before it's published and to make sure that they've gone through it line by line and to talk about it. Because to fling it out there when they don't know what to expect, when they don't have the sort of cultural reservoir to know what to expect, seems wrong to me. So I've done that every time. I've given the person a draft of the book to read and given them the time to read it and discuss it with me and raise problems.
Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about some of the twists and turns that you mentioned. It's a thriller, and even if you do know some of the twists and turns, it's a book that you really need to read. But after you got that court record of their 1992 trial, the story does take a twist. Can you describe the moment when you realized that the story had gone down that rabbit hole?
So I don't want to get too caught up in the detail, and it is quite a detailed story, but very, very briefly, the story Fusi remembers of what happened on the 2nd of April, 1992. He was an ordinary young man living in the rural town of Bethlehem in the Free State. He was 25 years old. He only had a standard 7 education, a grade 9. He worked as a cashier in Checkers. There's a knock on his door early one morning. It's his brother-in-law who lives in Tokoza on the East Rand of Johannesburg, which is at that stage at war with Nkata. This is the transition to democracy. It's 1992. It's a very tough time in the East Rand. There are a whole lot of men with his brother-in-law. They all look nervous. A couple of them have bulges under their shirts. They stay a few hours and drive on. By evening, his brother-in-law is back and says something terrible has happened. And he said, I'm actually a member of a self-defense unit. We were on our way to Natal to give arms to comrades there who were fighting in Carter. The police stopped us on our way out of Bethlehem. We opened fire and we killed one of them, and now I'm hiding. Later that night, the door was knocked down. Security police came in, hauled everyone in jail. And to cut a long story very short, the security police's story is that Fusi had brought these men to town. Fusi Ansakolo had brought these men to town in order to rob a rich white man who lived on a small holding on the outskirts of town. Fusi ended up being charged with murder, not because he was on the scene, but by common purpose, and he was found guilty and put in prison. His entire 19 years in prison, he dedicated to showing the world that he was not guilty. He literally threw his sweat, blood, his entire identity at showing the world his innocence. He finished his schooling. He studied law. He learned to speak English properly and to write English properly so that people would understand him. He wrote to Winnie Mandela, to Bishop Tutu, to the South African ambassador to Angola, who he thought that he once knew, everybody. Finally, he's let out on parole. I'm writing his story, the story of an innocent man. 2-3 years into working with him, the transcript of the actual trial that convicted him, which had been missing, was suddenly found. All the audio tapes were found, and I had them transcribed. And to my shock, I found that his memory was not just unreliable, there were parts of it that were really violently wrong. And reading this transcript and seeing some of what actually happened in 1992, it dawned on me what had happened to his memory over the years. He had taken what was said at the TRC 6 years later, which was really all fabricated. It was just a story people told to get off. And he had transposed that testimony from the TRC onto the actual day of the 2nd of April, 1992, and remembered it thus. And that really put me in a quandary. What do I do with this? You know, I'm collaborating with this man to tell his story. And yet I've come to believe that his story is untrue and that he doesn't know that his story is untrue. What does one do with that? Much more to say, but let's stop there for the moment.
Yeah, stop there. But I do have, because in the book, you say to him, you come to him, you say, I don't really know what happened on the 2nd of April, 1992. And you give him the option. You say, well, if you don't want me to continue, I won't. And he says, to his credit, he says, you know, let the readers decide and draw their own conclusions. But you'd already spent, I mean, years on this project. Would you have been able to just walk away from it?
Well, so just to complete the picture, I mean, my view, I never found out exactly what happened on that day, but I think there's a very, very strong possibility that he was involved in that murder and no longer believes that he was. I mean, when I discovered that, I just put down the book. I didn't want to write it anymore. It was just too uncomfortable. And I told him that. I told him that I was really reconsidering. And then it just sat with me month after month, and that felt wrong. And maybe one of the reasons it felt wrong is precisely, as you say, I'd spent years on this project and I wasn't going to let it go. But another reason, which seemed to me more credible and more interesting, is that Fusi is really an extraordinary person, a very, very unusual person. You know, he spent the first 2 decades of his adult life in prison and then walked out with no adult experience in the world into Boklokong, the township of Bethlehem, where there's 60-70% unemployment. There are huge, huge social problems, alcohol abuse. He walked into this incredibly difficult world and he immediately flourished in all aspects of his life. He fell in love. He adopted his new wife's children. He started work as a lowly assistant mechanic in the municipality, earning 5,000 rand a month, shot through the ranks into middle management. Here was an incredibly competent person, incredibly skilled, incredibly emotionally intact, a very, very decent person. And to spend 20 years in prison and to walk out like that is really, really unusual. And I thought to myself, I had a hunch that there was a causal connection between the fact that his memory was so bad and that he'd forgotten what happened, and his decency. And I thought that, you know, I think of myself as a writer. And if I can't write that story, you know, if that story is beyond me, then what am I doing? I really felt that I had an obligation to him, to the story, and to my craft, to go back and try and write it.
I mean, the book aims to explore, the book explores the issue of memory, what we remember, what we misremember, what we forget. And you get people to dig into their memories, not only Fusi, but everybody that you spoke to, and you spoke to everybody that was involved, and warders, and you know, the amount of research that you did was really incredible. Memory plays tricks on us and should be treated with skepticism. Is it ever possible to trust somebody's memories?
So, I mean, the short answer, I think, is no. You know, and very much, you know, my memory, everybody's memories. And I mean, one reason is that the very act of remembering is reconstructing. You know, there is no memory of a minute by minute, second by second film of what happened. We are selecting, reconstructing. And more than that, we're telling stories every time we remember. And a story isn't reality. You know, reality happens, it spools across time with no particular meaning. It's not shaped into a narrative. When we remember, we're making up a story. We're reshaping that material from the real world into a story. And whether we're conscious of it or not, we always have a purpose to telling that story. It's very often a self-justifying purpose. Sometimes it's a self-lacerating purpose, but there's always a moral dimension to why we're telling the story we're telling. And in that sense, what we remember, I think, is as reflective of who we are here and now as to anything that happened in the past.
Maybe it's because of all these happily ever after fairy tales we were told as children and all the Hollywood movies that we watched, but we want our stories to be all neat and tidy and wrapped in a bow. We want the loose ends to be tied up. so that we can understand it and make sense of it. But the truth is not neat and simple or easy. It's contested. It has twists and turns. It's full of contradictions and ambiguity, accusations and counter-accusations. However, you're not scared of messy, unresolved endings. So did you not read any happily ever after fairy tales or watch Hollywood movies?
You know, I think I still have a hangover from my teenage days when I was very gloomy and lugubrious and dark and felt that there was great wisdom in complexity. I'm not attracted to simple stories. I think that we're, you know, we are dark and complex beings. We hide things from ourselves. We don't know the truth about ourselves. And those are things worth writing. But I think it's one thing telling a dark story and a complex story. But I think that if you can tell something dark and complex with empathy, and even with love, you know, the danger of being sentimental. I mean, for me, that's the most powerful work, the most powerful writing, art, movies. I think that combination of not shying away from darkness, but opening up one's heart is a very good formula for saying something, for describing the world well.
One Day in Bethlehem is not just the story of Fusi and Tsokolo. It's a chunk of South African history where different lives intersected and are changed by what happened on the 2nd of April, 1992. Fusi, Tsokolo, the 8 self-defense unit fighters in the Bucky, Constable Lawrence Oosthuizen and his grieving father, Captain Colin Robertshaw, the oarsmen's. It's also about the miscarriages of justice, South Africa's flawed justice system, the Golden Products Pyramid Scheme, the IFP-ANC war on the East Rand, the shortcomings of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. It's the juncture of South Africa's past and present with all its glaring contradictions. How did you keep all these different threads and all these disparate themes in this complicated narrative together? There was a lot.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that, because I mean, one of the things that I was trying to do was show the sheer madness of everyday life in the early 1990s. I think that very few of us remember that. I don't think that our national narrative can afford to remember that. And one of the things I wanted to do was just throw the sheer craziness of the world at that time in the reader's face. I wanted them to feel it, you know, to smell it. And the question of how you hold that all together, you know, I think it's really the question of having a strong narrative spine. And if there is this, you know, if there's a center of gravity, a center of focus, you know, in this case, whether it's worked or not is up to the reader to judge rather than me. But the attempt was to delve into one man's journey and one man's memory and a strange question about that memory. And if that quest has spine, if that is strong, then you can wander all over the place and gather all these stories that you've just alluded to and still come back to the center. You know, if the center's strong, you can drift far and wide. If the center's not strong, then it just becomes a mess, then it collapses into meaninglessness.
I mean, I was particularly interested in the East Rand of the 1990s, that, and as you said, it hasn't been very well written about or spoken about. We seem to have forgotten about it. And I did some work in that time with an organization called the Independent Board of Inquiry. And we were looking at the security police's role in stoking the violence. And it was horrific. Dead bodies piled up after the weekend, which you write about, and they were left until Monday mornings when the police would come and pick them up. And I remember one of my colleagues telling me how he had witnessed schoolboys playing soccer in a field and how they'd use the dead body as one of their goalposts. And I wondered what being exposed to that terrible violence would do to that generation of children. And when I was reading One Day in Bethlehem, I wondered about the children of Fushi's sister, Victoria. In 1992, they would have been the age of the boys playing soccer with the dead body. Did you meet them?
No, I didn't, unfortunately. Perhaps one of the reasons why I didn't venture there is what I was most interested in about those times was was those ordinary people who ended up killing. You know, I wanted to know what it meant for them. And those people who arrived at Fusi's house at 7 o'clock in the morning on the 2nd of April, 1992, it was a car of eight people. They were drawn from all over Southern Africa. They hadn't known one another a year or two before. Some were Mozambican, some were Sotho, some were Xhosa. They were really just this cosmopolitan group of people who'd stumbled together because they all came to live in this informal settlement. And all of them by then had killed, and they'd killed together. And these were ordinary people. They weren't good people. They weren't bad people. They were just ordinary people. And history had thrown them into this disastrous situation where they ended up taking human lives. And what interests me most is what happens to them next? What happens to them over the next 10 years, the next 20 years? What does it mean to have killed? For it not really to have been acknowledged in the world that you have, for your national narrative not really be able to absorb what you've done, how do people live with that? So I guess that's what I try to write into those times, is these people come together, they end up in a time and a place, and they do terrible things, not because they're terrible people, because that's where they are there and then.
The justice system repeatedly failed Fusi, and you capture his helplessness and powerlessness. A string of lawyers kept letting him down, even in the new dispensation. The TRC scene was heartbreaking, where he was told he could not apply for amnesty because he did not commit a crime, and there was no system in place for dealing with miscarriages of justice. The wheels of justice turned very slowly. And when I got to the part where Jacques Poe or Jack Poe comes to visit Fusi in prison, it felt like the cavalry had arrived, the power of journalism to save the day. What would have happened if the Wits Justice Project and Jacques hadn't highlighted this particular injustice? Would Fusi and Chikolo still be in prison?
Good question. I think they'd be out by now, but they would have been in a little while longer. You know, the Wits Justice Project, they could only help them in a limited way. You know, there's this weird gap, this weird lacuna in South African criminal law where you can't reopen a case that's closed, even if there's new evidence. And so all they managed to do was get them out on parole a little earlier. But it is really a very, very dark and nasty story, what happened to Fusi in the criminal justice system. And this was after the end of apartheid. You know, at a formal level, everything worked really well. He applied to the Legal Aid Board and was given an advocate. The advocate didn't listen to him, wasn't interested in him, didn't forward a proper case, and so he lost. He appealed, went back to the Legal Aid Board, was given another advocate, and this one did even less for him. This one didn't even show him the statement that she'd written on his behalf. He just was given the final page to sign. You know, the TRC was this incredibly elaborate way to bring transitional justice to people. He only met his lawyer the morning of the case, and it was too late for his lawyer to help him. So you really see in real time how the system, formally in terms of its rules, is working fine. All that's missing are human beings who really give a shit about the people they're working for. You know, nobody cared because he was poor. He was invisible to the people who were meant to be working on his behalf. So it's quite amazing to see how a system can work on paper and absolutely collapse in practice just because the client sitting in front of you is inarticulate and poor and black, and it's tickets for him. Nobody's going to help him.
In a very weird sense, prison might have saved Fusi. He came from a place and time where young and poor black men had very little opportunities. Indeed, the lives of the friends he was hanging out with at the time of his arrest all ended very tragically. Fusi walked out of prison when he was, and you mentioned that he's been flourishing and has made a success of his life. How did prison change him?
So, I mean, that goes back to this question that really interested me, was what was the connection between the fact that he had such an unreliable memory and was such a good person? You know, I think, and this is it's a difficult thought, and I just want to sort of put it as plainly as possible. I think that what happened to him in prison is that he entirely reinvented his past, reimagined the whole thing, you know, from childhood through his teenage years. He essentially, he told the story of a life that was going well, that was in a sense idyllic, even though that really in reality wasn't true at all. And really resurrected himself into the sort of person who could be functional and who could be decent. And the strange thing is, I think that if he'd never gone to prison, he'd never have turned into that decent person. He'd never have had the opportunity to reimagine himself, to reinvent who he was. You know, when he was a teenager, he spent every weekend with these three other guys who he was very, very close to and spoke very, very fondly of. One was his brother, another was his cousin, another was his best friend. They'd meet on Fridays, they'd start drinking, they'd chase women together, they did what kids do. And if you look at what happened to the others, his brother, a couple of years after Fusi went to jail, got drunk one night and flipped his car and died. Second one got AIDS a few years later and died. The third one is alive, but he's lived this incredibly messy, sad life. He has kids all over the place. He can't hold down a job. He doesn't know how to be a father. I mean, weirdly, of this group of kids who were, you know, wild in their teens, the one who's turned out right is the one who was whisked away and taken to jail, you know, the key locked away. He's the one who's okay. And Fusi doesn't remember this at all, but, you know, back in 1992, during his trial, he stood up on the witness stand and I read the transcript. And you can just tell from bits of the transcript how his life was falling apart at that time. He was chronically ill. He couldn't find a cure. He was unemployed. He'd literally forgotten all of this as an adult when he met me. It was only visible in the transcript. And you could just see the mess that he was going to become. And the extent to which he utterly reinvented himself, a real personal renovation without really knowing that that's what he was doing. And for me, that was the key to why there was this causal connection between a really poor memory and a really good person. We kind of habitually think that to fictionalize about ourselves is morally bad. You know, we think that to be a good person, you need to hold the truth about yourself. So much of our expertise says that. Psychoanalysis says that all unhappiness comes from repressing the past. Traumatic disorder is meant to be about not dealing with things that happened in the past. I think that his capacity to fictionalize is what saved him. I think it's a huge tribute to human inventiveness and adaptability. So I came out with a renewed respect for fiction, a renewed respect for actually not knowing what happened to you in the past and inventing something new. I thought that this really worked.
I'm curious about you. You mentioned that you'd showed him the book, but I'm curious, what did he think about it?
You know, he's a very opaque, very silent person, and he keeps a lot to himself. And I'm to this day not entirely sure what he thinks. But I suspect, I can just sense that a part of him is sort of quite, in a strange way, excited by this tension, you know, by me having one story and him having another. I was quite bowled over when I was very nervous. I went to him and I said, Fusi, this is what I think happened, that your story can't be true. And there was this very strange moment. We were in my car. A car is a very, very intense place. There was this very strange moment where he tried to suggest that we were both right, that there could somehow be these two parallel universes. You know, I was right in one, and he was right in another. But eventually he said to me, you know, I don't know all that much about the writing of books, but I do know that when you meet a person, you don't know them yet. And you started out in your exploration and this is what you found, and that's fine. All I ask of you is that you say that this is your interpretation, that there are other possibilities. Just lay those out on the page and I'll be fine. It was an incredibly generous, sophisticated, measured response. And it's some reflection of why he's done so well since he's left jail. He has this incredible calm, this incredible capacity to stand back from a situation and reflect on it.
He wasn't always calm. I mean, he was in prison, he was angry and depressed. How did he deal with that? How did he find calmness?
So It was through a particular relationship with, ironically, with the, you know, white Afrikaans Freestater, who until then he'd assumed was his enemy. It was a social worker in prison. The social worker just came up to him. No, this was just after the TRC had told him that they couldn't help him. And he was very, very down. He was dysfunctionally depressed. I think he was clinically depressed. I think that he was really going somewhere very dark, somewhere it may have been quite hard to come back from. And the social worker said to him, just out of the blue, what's the matter? And he said, nothing's the matter, I'm fine. And he said, no, you're not. I can see that you are so angry that you are killing yourself. And he just said it like that. If you don't get rid of your anger, you're going to die. I can see it. I've seen it before. And he develops a relationship with the social worker. And the most important thing the social worker said to him was, what has happened in the past has happened. You can't change it. You can't fight with what's already happened. It's a fight you can't win. It's a fight that will eventually destroy you. And for him, that was an absolute revelation that he could just let go and look to the future. And I think that's the moment when things really, really turned for him. It was an epiphany.
I'm curious to know what, if you've had any responses from any of the other characters in the book.
So weirdly, I'm doing a virtual thing with a book club in Bethlehem. Okay. And today I got an email from the convener of the book club. You know, these are all white people from Bethlehem. Most of them have lived in Bethlehem for generations. She gave me a list of the questions and responses. Many of them are absolutely furious. They absolutely don't like this outsider coming in and meddling and telling this very difficult story. So I'm quite looking forward to engaging with them in person in this book club. I think that it'll be really interesting and really rewarding.
And any formal responses? I mean, because you name all the lawyers that let him down, the woman at the ANC on the ANC's desk that let him down. Constable Oosthuizen's father. Any responses from them?
Nothing yet, but my past experience would suggest that these things come out over time. But so far, nothing terribly controversial.
Okay. In all your books, you have spent an extraordinary amount of time with the people you write about: Sizwe Magadla, Magadine Wenzel, Asad Abdullah. You have an intense engagement with them, and you come to know them in a way that is intimate. Does that connection continue after the book is published?
It really depends on the person. Some people, the relationship doesn't last very long. Other people, it lasts, until today. It's so variable. So the guy I wrote about in A Man of Good Hope, the Somali migrant, we're in touch pretty often. He lives in America and we speak every few months. Sizwe from Three to the Plague, who lives in the Transkei, we're in touch from time to time. Others, Makhedin from The Number, not at all. So it really varies. I mean, I think that also when people are written about that intensely, they have different responses over time after the book is published. You know, some people are left feeling warm and happy with the experience. Other people, with Makhedin, it left a bad taste in his mouth. He looked back in it and didn't think that it worked for him. So it can be a tricky relationship.
19 years of Fussy's life was stolen. And he was forgotten in prison, and his family had been forgotten on the farms. There's a powerful quote from him where he says, "We are ordinary people, we tend to be forgotten." Do you think he still feels forgotten after the book has come out?
I think whether or not the book was published, he was a forgotten person who became recognized, and did so through an extraordinary inner strength and extraordinary capacity to negotiate the world. And weirdly, the only reason there's a book about him is because he's that person. There were two people at the heart of the story, Fussy and his friend Tsokolo Mokoena. And the first time I met them together, it was absolutely clear from the beginning that I could never write a book about Sekolo Mokoena. We would not have been able to sustain enough communication, enough of a connection. And one of the reasons is that Fusi was a healthy person and Sekolo was suffering and in pain. So in a weird sort of way, Fusi chose himself to be written about because he was flourishing. Sekolo is absolutely silent in this book because he was not. And that goes back to what I was saying at the beginning, that people really do choose themselves. It's really not me. You know, I'm the one, in a sense, who can't choose. I can't write about Sekolo. It's a limitation of mine. I can only write about the one who flourishes.
What message do you want people to take away from the book?
Oh, no message. I think one of the best things about writing a book is the unexpected responses that people bring back. I mean, to want to force a response on them is kind of flies in the face of what writing is about. You know, whether positive or negative, whether people are angry, whether they're happy, I'm always so incredibly pleased to hear responses that I wasn't expecting, to see interpretations I wasn't expecting. It's very humbling and very rewarding.
What project are you working on now?
So something very, very different. I'm writing a book about the marriage of Winnie and Nelson Mandela.
It's very different.
It's very different. I've always written about living people and these are dead people. I've always written about anonymous people, ordinary people. And just for a number of reasons in the last few years, I've become very intrigued about human beings who exercise power and what it means for their inner worlds, for their subjectivities, for who they are, for how they negotiate with others. I've been wanting to write about that for a long time. And these are two formidable people who exercised massive power and in such different ways, all in one marriage. So it seemed a very exciting story.
Wow. Before we open up to people who are watching, I've got just some sort of general lockdown questions for you. You're in lockdown in London. What have you done to prevent yourself from going crazy?
So I'm actually in Oxford, which is It's such a beautiful town. And unlike you, we haven't had these bizarre restrictions of first no exercise and then only 3 hours a day. So, you know, I've really kind of discovered the seasons in a way that I've never noticed them before. You know, I go walking in parks and in the countryside every day, and just watch the changes in the world as summer comes on while you're going into winter. And other than that, I've been in my office working on this book. In a way, I feel a bit guilty. I mean, on one hand, I'm incredibly anxious. This is a very, very difficult and uncertain time. And I'm acutely aware of how uncertain the future is for all of us. And it really gets to me at times. On the other hand, I'm really built for lockdown. I have this consuming project, which I do by myself. And it's really been a refuge. I mean, the world is tough right now. The world in this pandemic is hard. And to be able to escape into the 1960s and 70s and into this very, very rich world has really been a godsend for me.
Okay, so on that note, I think we're going to, and I'm going to see, there's just one question. So if people want to send questions, you just have to type in the Q&A box. From Barbara, how did you know when the book was complete?
Good question. I mean, when you're writing about living people, when, you know, the life isn't finished, the life goes on after you've written the last sentence. So how do you finish the book? I mean, for me, any book that's worth its salt must try to answer a question, a overarching question. And the book is finished once that question is answered, to the best of my ability. And the question that I was grappling with was, what is this connection between this man's unreliable memory and his decency? How do I answer that connection? And that's where the whole book was arcing. And once I'd given my best answer to that question, the book was done.
That's from Nancy Richards. How is it writing about South Africa from a distance? Does it help or hinder?
I've no idea. I mean, I often wonder about that, and I've no way of telling. I mean, in a way, it's the same, because when I lived in South Africa, I lived in Joburg mainly, but I was never writing about Joburg. So I'd go on these expeditions of like 10 days, 2 weeks to the Transkei, to Cape Town, to the KZN Midlands. And I guess that I kind of do the same now, except that I'm traveling from the UK. So in that sense, the rhythm and the process is quite similar. But I mean, living out of South Africa is different, and I don't know what that means. Sometimes I think that it means I'm losing touch. Sometimes it makes me think that I actually can see more because I've managed to take my head out of these endless stream of the same conversation and see things differently. I don't know. It's a question that really confuses me. I'm not sure. But I do like living in two worlds. I do like having a personal, social, and professional life here and back in South Africa. I enjoy being in both, but not quite in both.
And then my very kind sister says, not a question, but thank you both for a really worthwhile and interesting discussion.
Well, thanks very much.
A Man of Good Hope became a musical. Do you see that there may be another format for Bethlehem, a film? I do think that it should be a film. I agree with Nancy.
I have no idea. I mean, that's up for others. If somebody comes along with a proposal, I'll look at it, but I haven't really thought of it.
I think there's another question, but from Toby, what concerns do the book club ladies have with the information emerging from the book?
Well, I'll have a much better sense of that when I actually meet them. You know, what I have now is quite scattered. But, you know, 2/3 of the book is about what white people did to black people. And I think that it makes them extremely uncomfortable. And I think that a lot of white South Africa is in that space right now and is quite offended by a story of that nature. I mean, I also think that, I mean, what the book's saying is pretty complex about, you know, what the truth is, about how much it matters what the truth is. And if you come from that world, if you've lived your life in Bethlehem and some outsider comes and says how complicated everything is and how, you know, whether a story is true or not may not matter, I think that can offend. And I kind of get that. I understand that. So that's what I'm anticipating when I go to this book club. People saying, you come into that world and you play with it. Why do you do that with it? It's our world. That's what I'm expecting, but I don't know. I mean, people surprise you. We'll see what people say, but I'm really looking forward to that.
How do you stop or prevent your personal opinions from influencing the story?
Oh, I don't. I mean, you can't write a story from nowhere. You have to bring yourself into it. I think, you know, you bring your opinions into it, but as long as you also bring your judgments into it, as long as you keep your sense of perspective and judgment, I think that really, really matters. And I mean, by bringing your opinions into it doesn't mean being opinionated. I think you can both have opinions and be humble. You know, I think that you can... I like to think that it's possible to stand back and let a story wash over you in a way that does make you feel humble, because you get a sense of how big the world is, how hard it is to comprehend and keep in your head, sense of how the things that other people have gone through really demand a huge amount of respect. I mean, I like to hope that that's all possible to put in the writing, to reflect in the writing.
Was your curiosity about people in history ignited during school? Later, was there someone who particularly influenced you?
So I had two absolutely extraordinary teachers at school, and they really made me. I mean, what I'd be, who I'd be, I really have no idea. You know, I was at high school, at Hyde Park High School in the northern suburbs of Johannesburg from 1983 to 1987, you know, the heart of 1980s apartheid. And I had an English teacher who was enormously charismatic. His name was Sen Skonken. And he managed to take in literature from other parts of the world and make it speak to what was going on around me in ways that were, that really just blew my mind. And that was in grade 9. And grade 11, I had a history teacher called Dave Edwards, who in this very, very calm, he was a bit like a Fusi. He was a very silent type, a very reflective type. And he just through the discipline of history, tried to show how our world was shaped about the social forces that had made it. And when that comes to you for the first time in your life, it's enormously powerful. So I think the world is made by teachers. You know, I think that we become who we are through our relation to others, and particularly through our relation to those people through whom we learn. It's a weird, fascinating, and very, very strong relationship to imbibe knowledge by imbibing another human being. You know, there's something quite magical and mysterious, even dangerous about it. In a sense, one's being seduced by a teacher. But I think it's really what makes the world tick.
Could you please enlighten me as to what made you see unreliable memory as being diametrically opposed to being a good person?
So it was partly just this puzzle of Fusi, you know, and the fact that I discovered just how violently unreliable his memory was. It was such a shock. And yet I'd experienced his enormous competence as a human being. And it just kind of naturally came to me, what is the connection between these two things? But I also had a lot of help along the way. I mean, I read a number of anthropologists and philosophers who, you know, once I was interested in this question between fictionalizing one's past and one's moral capacities as a human being, I started reading about it. And I read a philosopher called Ian Hacking, a Canadian philosopher who wrote what I think is a really extraordinary book about just these questions, about how radically a person can reinvent themselves by reimagining what their past was. Also a couple of anthropologists. So it was a long and circuitous route, but it began with this puzzle. You know, how is it that this man has potentially forgotten that he was involved in a murder, and yet he is anything but a murderer. He's a profoundly good human being. What's the connection between those two things?
Andrew, who's an English teacher, wants to know if there was anyone when you were younger who influenced you in becoming a writer?
I mean, I think that these two school teachers I mentioned, you know, really, really shaped my relation to the world. Why that turned out to wanting to be a writer, I just don't remember. I mean, we've been talking about the unreliability of memory here. And I just feel that if I answer that, I'd make it up. I just don't know. I think that I've wanted to write since I can remember, and I've no idea why. I've no idea where exactly that's come from. I didn't meet any professional writer until I became one myself. So there was no direct influence in that way.
Could you write stories set in other countries and contexts?
So I partly have. I mean, I wrote this book, Little Liberia, which took place in New York and was about Liberians. I found it quite hard. I think that writer's block is this really scary thing, and it comes from two sources. And one of them is just knowing that you don't know enough. Knowing that every paragraph you write down, every page you write down is just not getting enough of the world into it. And if you're writing nonfiction, you need a pretty long, deep knowledge of the place you're writing about. And writing about New York and Liberia, I just never quite felt comfortable, whereas South Africa was really in my blood. You know, it's not just the place where I grew up, it's the place that I'm so very, you know, invested in intellectually, emotionally, you know, whose history that I've read as much as I can. It's just much, much easier writing about a world with, you know, with which one is deeply familiar and invested. It's much easier.
Weren't you anxious that when you confronted Fusi with the tapes, his identity would fall apart?
Yeah, there was a time when I was worried about that. And I happened to be having lunch with a psychologist. I mean, I didn't meet this person for this reason, but I told him the story, and this person said, what are you doing? You're going to destroy this person. You know, this is their self-conception. What are you doing? And that was the moment I thought, God, well, I can't write this book. I mean, what right do I have? And that was, it was profoundly wrong and also presumptuous about my power over this man. You know, he's, in his very quiet way, he's quite formidable. He is centered. He has a very, very strong foundation. You know, so much so that when somebody comes, been working with for 2 years, comes and says, I don't believe your story, he says, fine. So it was really a lesson in exaggerating my own omnipotence, my own power. It was quite humbling to see how little it actually mattered to him.
I'm rightly saying
questions because you confront such similar issues. you also write about living people for whom the stakes are very, very high. You write about their dark pasts. You're asking all these questions of me. These are questions that you think about all the time.
You rightly say memory is a reconstruction and often contested. Is it possible that white South Africans could use this as a way of avoiding thinking about apartheid and forms of complicity? Many of us, myself included, were and are a part of.
Your voice is breaking up a little, but I think that I got the sense of it. I think that you know, I think that acknowledging that you come from the heart of a history which did wrong is very, very difficult. It's difficult for anybody. And I, you know, having lived in the UK now for a few years, I really see it here in a profound way that, you know, this country, you know, cannot have an idea that it was, it has an imperialist past, that it went and colonized people. You know, that in places like India and Kenya, it killed many, many people. it's not a self-conception that one can live with very easily. And how one negotiates it is always hard, always requires work. And I also think requires a little bit of leeway. I think that white people under attack in South Africa respond by attacking back or defensively, or, you know, getting into this very defensive crouch, this very horrible posture. It's a, you know, what to do with people who've been nasty to others in the past is one of the most difficult and tractable questions. It never really goes away.
Do you have hope in South Africa's future?
You know, it's very, very deep in South African culture to think apocalyptically about South Africa. And it goes right back to the beginning. And it comes from a white minority living in a black country. I think it's been hardwired in us for a long, long time that things could explode. And it's there from the beginning. It's there in the first parliamentary debates in 1910. You know, if we don't sort out the native question, we will get crushed. It's there when the National Party comes to power in 1948. You know, we need to take hold of this country or we'll be destroyed. You know, then it's there when Thabo Mbeki is president, saying that if we don't take care of poverty, this country will be destroyed. We've kind of been waiting for an apocalypse forever. And I don't think this apocalypse will ever come. I think that there's a huge amount of resilience. I do think that COVID-19 is a big, big deal. And it was a terrible thing to happen to South Africa. And after the recovery, it will be a different place. It will be poorer. It will probably be in debt. There will be levels of poverty which are much harder to hide. The poverty will be, the politics will be more difficult. You know, I think that something genuinely terrible has happened. And it's going to be a hard, hard struggle getting out of it. It's going to take a long time.
Which publications do you read regularly? Newspapers, magazines?
So I'm not sure how interesting it is to everybody, but I have a morning ritual. I read Business Day and News 24 and Daily Maverick and the Financial Times and the New York Times. And that's like the first, I don't know, hour and a half of my day. And then I feel ready to confront the world. It's just become this daily habit. You know, we're all going through a transition of how we read with apps and with social media. But that's, I'm an old habitual person, and that's more or less what I stick to.
And I think this is our final question. Where is he? And I'm guessing that he is Fussy. Where is Fussy today?
So Fussy is in Bethlehem, and he's working for the municipality. He's doing incredibly well. As I say, he started as an assistant mechanic. He's now a manager. He's a very, very shrewd person. You know, he knows how to manage the politics of an organization, and he's done pretty well. He's married to a woman he met soon after he came out. He's adopted her children. He has a child of his own and a grandchild. He's doing pretty well. For those of you who arrived early and were listening to the Righteous Brothers song in the waiting room, he chose it. I texted him last night and asked him what song he would like. And he chose the cheesiest dramatic song I can think of. So that was his contribution to this evening.
Well, Jonny, congratulations. This really is an impressive book. I think it's one of the best books that's come out of South Africa for a very long time. And it's available at the Book Lounge, which you can, if you don't want to go there, they will deliver it. And also on Amazon, you can order it from Amazon.
Jonathan, thanks so much.
Thank you. Yeah.
I really appreciate the discussion.
No, the pleasure is mine. Thanks very much to Beryl and to Joe and to Natasha and to the Jewish Literary Festival and to Cindy. Yeah. Alone, lonely time. In time.
I'd like to say a very, very, very warm thank you to both Jonny and to Jonathan. What a wonderfully absorbing and mesmerizing conversation. As Jonathan mentioned, the book, Jonny's books are available on Amazon.com, or you can order them from the Book Lounge. Just email thebooklounge@gmail.com or call them on 021-462-2425, and they will organize either pickup or delivery. I'd like to say another thank you to our audience for your wonderful support, for the Jewish Literary Festival, to the sponsors and the donors of JLF 2020, to Natasha Skorik for her wonderful technical coordination, and to the JLF team for their programming coordination. Our grateful thanks to everybody who's been involved. Just a reminder, watch your email for when we're going to do another webinar, and we look forward to you joining us again. Thank you, stay warm, and stay safe. I'll be coming.